My main interest is really trying to look at the relationship between diet and nutrition and brain health. So we're really interested in trying to understand what it is about our diet that may increase our risk in terms of cognitive loss as we age, or more optimistically, what can we do at a proactive level in terms of helping to retain our brain function with aging, using diet as one of the interventions. We were really the first to show that the average North American diet, if consumed in middle age, can contribute to cognitive decline. When we first started doing this work, people were arguing that the brain was insensitive to diet after development, so that we didn't have to worry about brain function after we were about 7 or 8 years of age and we had all of our, you know, brain tissue there, that after that the brain was protected. And so not only was our data showing, no, that's not true, our brain continues to be sensitive to our diet, but it was also saying that the types of eating patterns that were traditional in North America, particularly high fat, high meat, low in fruits and vegetables, were contributing to cognitive decline. I think what's really interesting when you start to look at issues around nutrition and brain health is to recognize that those issues change dramatically as we move throughout the lifespan. So for instance, when we're in our 50s and 60s, that's when we can be most proactive in terms of changing our lifestyle. So we're doing what we can in terms of setting our brains up for healthy aging. And so the focus at that point really needs to be on maintaining our body weights, doing what we can to prevent heart disease and diabetes, because those are adverse for brain function, and that needs to be our focus. As we get into our senior years, we need to start shifting the way that we think about nutrition. And the main thing is that we shouldn't be trying to lose weight. And I think a lot of it is that as we get older, we're more likely to lose muscle than we are to lose fat, and that can contribute to frailty. So what we need to do in our 50s and 60s is make sure that we get into a healthy body weight range. And then once we get into our 70s and beyond, is really being focused on retaining that body weight rather than trying to move it upwards or downwards. One of the problems that we often have when we're trying to give nutrition advice is that people are wanting easy answers. So they either want to know whether a specific nutrition supplement is good, whether an individual food is good. And I think the answer to that is more complex. What we know in terms of looking at some longitudinal studies of seniors and seniors that are aging well and they're retaining their cognitive function is that we can describe their diet. Their diet is high in fruits and vegetables. They're not eating a lot of animal fat, so even if they're eating things like beef, they're taking lean cuts. And we know that that diet pattern is very healthy. And so it's true that you'll read in the newspaper that blueberries are healthy, and yes, blueberries are healthy, but so are raspberries and strawberries and all sorts of other fruits and vegetables. And I would argue the important thing is to make sure that you take advantage of the cornucopia of food that's available in North America and eat as wide a variety as you possibly can, rather than trying to focus on individual foods. It's a magnificent place to work. I'm coming from a discipline where there's not a lot of people in nutrition that are working in cognitive health. And I'm in an environment where everybody around me is bringing different forms of expertise as it relates to trying to sustain and maintain brain function as we age. And it's that interdisciplinary, collaborative nature of the environment here that makes it so fruitful in terms of the research. So I can work with cognitive psychologists so that I know my work, while I can describe nutrition interventions, is grounded in cognitive psychology because I work with that expertise on a daily basis. And so I think it's the breadth, the collaborative nature, and then just the expertise of the people that are here. We have some of the best people in the world doing cognitive psychology at Baycrest. And so it is such a privilege now to come in as somebody from a different discipline and be able to play with those people and work with them on a daily basis.